Welcome. Today we're going to be taking a look at a game with a somewhat unusual theme. This game is Blackbeard, the Golden Age of Piracy. The game design is by Richard Berg, and we're going to be looking at the 2008 GMT version, which is a reboot and redo of an Avalon Hill game from 1991 with the same title by the same designer, but with some very different mechanics and gameplay. I won't be doing a comparison because I haven't played the older game, but you should know if this is based on an older design. This game is designed for 1 to 5 players, but it has a built-in solitaire system, and the solitaire suitability here on the back of the game box is rated an 8 as high. And we'll get into whether or not I agree with that and why. The complexity on it is a 5 at medium. And as I said, it does play 1 to 5, but this video will be treating the game simply for its solitaire play. Playtime listed at about 2 hours. Again, my standard disclaimer on this, going through the game, certainly for the early times of play, I think that's a bit short on the end of length, but it could certainly be done in that time period once you're familiar with the rules. So let's open it up a little bit and take a look at some of the components, and then we'll get into a discussion of Blackbeard. You're looking here at the map of the game, which would be the game board, the gameplay area. And I should say that for those of you who don't know, Richard Berg, the designer of this game, is a prolific wargame designer. You can read about him really anywhere online that's gaming related. And yet the reboot of this game, I feel, has been an attempt to take what was perhaps a more traditional wargame, at least in terms of design and components, and make it more into a hybrid of perhaps more of a board game, a war game board game, or a board game where there's some conflict and war. And it's reflected initially, you can see here on the map. The old map had standard hexes on it and I believe was paper. This is a sort of thicker cardboard map, but it's not actually bound. And what happens when you play is you get this kind of bowing unless you really have it damped down for quite some time before you take it out to play. So there's that. It's a little bit of an issue because you're going to be dealing with cardboard counters that when placed on here can easily slide off. But you've got the map here depicting various areas of the world broken into what is known as sea areas, which come into play in terms of movement allotment, and these transit boxes that exist in order to allow a boat or ship to go from different areas of the world without having to spend the entire game dealing with movement points. There are cards within this game, which we'll get into, and there are places here for your discards. When you're playing actually solo, as we'll talk about, these areas are not sufficient for what you need, so you have to improvise a little bit. And each of these boxes represent a port with various numbers for the port rating and its defense and some other designations that we'll get into as we go a little bit more into gameplay. But this is an overview of the board. It's quite nice looking. There's a very consistent color palette in this game, which is both, I think, a positive and a negative. As we'll see with the counters later on, they are also within this color palette of sort of browns and tans and reds, and it can get a little confusing because everything sort of mushes together, but it's a nice look, I think. There are game cards that are used in the game, and they are going to represent your ship type and various information about your ship, what ports you have attacked, what governors you may have bribed, a lot of other information about your status as a pirate. And these two, I think, they're printed on the same sort of semi-thick cardboard. They, as well, have some issue with a little bit of bowing or bending that can be somewhat frustrating when you've got a lot of counters on them. And we also have the cards here. There are, I believe, 110 cards in the game. They are event cards of various sorts, and then there are also the pirate cards, and these contain information about your particular character or characters as you play. So this is a look at some of the components that are not the counters in the game, some of the other components in the game that go along with the counters. And now we'll take a look at some of the counters. There are quite a few counters in this game, and I've punched mine out here and clipped them as well, but I've just left them in baggies. Usually I organize better than this, but for a variety of reasons I haven't done that yet with this game. We're not going to go over all the counters, but we'll just take a look at a couple of them here. I actually think the counters are very nicely done. They're not particularly thick, but they are very sturdy, and the artwork on them is quite nice, actually. This is one of the pirate counters for Edward Teach, otherwise known as Blackbeard, and when you are playing solo, you play Blackbeard. This is an example of a counter for a merchant ship. This is a warship here, actually. And you can see on the back, it's a warship. These ratings are for combat and speed on this. And this is, again, the back of this particular counter. There are hostages in the game. Here is an example of a colonist hostage. And the two numbers here refer to information that they can give you and their value to you when you are treating them as a hostage or potentially torturing them for information. Again, you're a pirate, so you're going to be potentially torturing some of your hostages. And here's another counter for a merchant ship, and this number up here represents the cargo rating of that particular ship. There are smaller counters as well that represent things, in this particular case, the attack history of that port. I believe that symbol there refers to an Arab port, and they are all very colorful, actually. Here they are in the bag, the various ports, and you have an opportunity to come into Dutch, English, French, Portuguese, Spanish, Arab, and of course your pirate ports, which are, there are three of them in the game. So there are quite a few counters in this game, and the setup at the initial gameplay, which we'll take a look at in a moment, really is not that difficult. And for somebody who's used to playing games with counters, and by those people, I would guess I'd mean mostly wargamers, this is going to seem very, very easy. For people who are perhaps used to playing games without counters, you may feel that you're sorting through a lot of things, and of course you have to punch out the counter sheets. I can't remember whether it comes with two or three counter sheets, but it's a little bit of more of a building process than you would be used to in a traditional Euro game or more traditional board game, but such as it is. The one thing I will mention with regard to the counters and solo play is the vast number of these numerical counters that you will use a little bit in the game, but there are really so many of them that you won't use because the components, of course, are designed for up to five people playing the game. So you're going to end up with a ton of these number counters that you won't be using in the game. But overall, there's quite a few of counters. And the last thing I'll mention on this end, it comes with three little, some black and white dice. They're not necessarily the best quality dice, but the black and the white works well with the theme of pirates. Before we get into some initial setup and some examples of game turns, I want to just point out a little bit about the rules here. And this is a prime example of where I feel that the game's, what I would call betwixt and between nature, betwixt and between a war game and a board game, really shows. The rules here, as I'm flipping through them, are, let's see, how many pages? Well, there's some charts at the end, and these are notes about the pirates. The actual rules, here's the nice detailed, can't really see it, but you can see that there's some lengthy, or at least one full page of solitaire rules here. They date to about 24 pages. And for a wargamer, somebody used to playing more traditional war games, I think these rules are going to be fairly straightforward. They'll be organized in a manner that is familiar to you, and they will be fairly easy to follow. There's the course of play. Well, of course, there's the setup, preparing for play, going into the course of play, and the various actions that you can take on both sides, explanations of the counters. Very familiar type of rule set for a wargamer. For a non-wargamer, looking at something like this as rules to a game, and, you know, 24 pages of something like this is probably going to be a little bit daunting. In terms of charts and tables, again, for a wargamer, very minimal. I think this is the only one page. There's a very basic cargo table that lets you calculate the amount of value of any merchant ships that you might be capturing, something about storm effects. As you can see, really, really basic for anyone used to playing any types of war games. So, you know, you roll on this and here's your effect. There's not even a cross-reference here. Victory points table, very, very basic to a war gamer. There are here procedural outlines in this player aid for everybody, what to do when various things happen. When a pirate wants to attack a port, here's your procedure all laid out for you. For example. Now, not all of this is relevant to the solitaire play. The solitaire rules differ a little bit from the group play, so not everything in here, at least on the inside, is relevant to the solo player. But this game has a huge footprint. I'm showing you here the map set up as well as the four pirate cards that you're going to need when you are playing solo, and there's just no way around it. I mean, this is taking up almost an entire dining room table, so that's something that you should be aware of when starting. Let me just take a moment before we actually set up to explain how you get going on the solitaire game as opposed to the regular rules. The setup to play solitaire isn't actually too bad, so there's a couple things you need to do. The deck of 110 cards is divided up into two different types of cards. You've got cards that are labeled must play immediately, and I don't know how many of those there are, but clearly less than half. And these are events that happen in this particular card. We might as well take a look at it here, that you're rolling some d6 and you're using the resultant roll to place some random counters on the board that will affect everybody playing. So this is a must play immediately card. Another example of one of those is here's a natural disaster. Same thing. This is sort of changing the state of the board. This is a random port getting destroyed, so that could affect you or another player. And here some storms at sea. The last time I played this game, this really afflicted me, where again a random die roll will result in some turmoil in the seas. So you have these must play immediately cards. You pull these out from the deck that is labeled hold until played. This is the much larger deck. And the hold until played deck contains two different types of cards. About 70% of them have this icon here designating that card as an anti-pirate action. And this is the way that the players interact in the game to cause misery for other players. As a solo player, you will be playing against essentially, you know, the AI. I think the instructions call it the system player. And there are rules so that when one of these cards is pulled from this hold until played, it must be played. So that is one of the ways in which you're interacting with the system player or the AI. Finally, to set up this deck, you will be pulling out, I think it amounts to these six cards. There are no duels in the solitaire version of this game, so these are the cards that enable a duel to occur. You'll be pulling those out, and this Finger of Fate card also, where you're exchanging cards with other players, is also pulled out. So it's a pretty minimal setup to get going, at least with the deck of cards, to play solitaire. Next, you'll need to be pulling out these four player mats, and your pirate card here. You are, as I mentioned, playing Blackbeard. So you will put your card next to your player mat, and the system player has at its control three different pirates, and I'll get into the details of how the actual game turn works, but what the result is you need to be pulling out all of these mats as well as your map board, which is what's resulting in, as I said, such a large footprint. I will say that I initially tried to avoid using these player mats because I found, as we'll see when we get into some gameplay examples, they end up having lots of counters on them, and they, mine are pretty flattened out now, but I had them underneath books for quite some time to get them this flat. I tried to keep my own books on paper to keep track of all these pieces of information, but it just got to be too annoying, so I went back to using these. They're a little unwieldy as far as I'm concerned, but they certainly serve the purpose. And again, you can see here, even though I don't have any counters out, there's a really consistent color palette to this game, which has its pluses and minuses, but overall it's a nice looking playmat and player area. All right, we're back here and we are set up to play a solitaire game. I'm trying to give you an overview of all the setup pieces, but again, the footprint on this is just so large, it's impossible to do that in one clear shot. So let's zoom in here and discuss a little bit about what you need to do to set up. Each port has a number by it, so the port rating here, for example, 34. This is used to help you place, through randomization of the throwing the dice, place some merchant ships, and you can see that they are placed upside down, so you don't know whether this merchant ship is particularly valuable or not. They are also used to place the pro-pirate governors. There are 8 pro-pirate governors in the game, and we'll talk about what that means in a moment. So to set up, you need to do your random placement of your merchant ships. I mentioned earlier dividing up the card decks, and this is where the board is not exactly right for solo play because there's no two different spots for these card decks, so you'll need to sort of place one over here. It's a little bit in the sea, but it won't really matter. And what else do you need to do? Well, you need to find a way to keep track of the actions available to your pirates. We are playing with a total of 4 pirates as a solo play, and I'll talk about how that breaks down in a moment. You are Blackbeard. I've designated Blackbeard as Pirate A here. And he has potentially up to 3 actions he can take. They have these markers in the game. It's a little frustrating because there are so many counters in the game, yet there are actually not enough. I had to move around my pirate to make Pirate D the one with only 1 action because there were only counters for D1 and D2. They didn't go up to 3 or 4, so it's a little curious. But in any case, you will need to keep track. It can get confusing as you're playing solo what action you're doing for what pirate. So I use this here to move through as I take the first action with Blackbeard, the second, etc. And when I'm playing Pirate 2, etc. It can get a little messy, but it's not too bad. So that is the overall map board. Oh, you have your pirate cards here. These are for the system player, or the AI may get new pirates in the game. The way the solitaire rules are set up, you play with Blackbeard throughout, and we'll talk about that a little bit at the end when I analyze how this system actually works. But the system player will be able, as part of the game, to retire pirates and get new pirates. One of the interesting facts about this game is that the victory points, here is the victory point track, and you have your little counters to keep track of where the victory points are for each player at any given time. Actions that you do result in victory points, and one of those actions is to go to a port and convert your booty, what you have collected, what you have stolen from the merchant ships, and convert that into your net worth. So you can't just be sailing around amassing tons and tons of money and wait it out and get to the end of the game, because you would become a target for intervention, for having your stuff stolen, basically. So what happens as part of the game is you need to find a port with a friendly governor, which will allow you to go and convert on a one-to-one basis the various booty that you have, money and other things that you have, and you would convert them effectively into victory points. So you're going to be keeping track of how your victory points go up and down on this board here. The player mats, as I mentioned earlier, there are four of them, and we'll just take a look here at what they contain. They contain a lot of information, actually. You choose, as a pirate, you can choose either a sloop or a schooner. The sloop is faster, it has a smaller cargo hold, and the schooner is slower with a bigger combat rating and a smaller cargo hold. I choose the schooner always, because the movement actually in this game, because there are such large sea areas, that frankly the movement is not really so much of an issue. Because if you're looking at the map here, as I pull back, you can see effectively this whole coastline here is one sea area. So that's just, you can go all the way over here. They have a transit box, which costs a movement to go into and to go out of, to represent, you know, something that approximates actual geography going from South America to the Gold Coast here. But I have found that it really makes little difference whether you have a slightly slower ship in terms of outrunning the King's Commissioners and other ships that are out to get you. So when I play, I choose the ship with the higher combat rating. In this case, the combat rating on the schooner is going to be a 6 as against a 5 on a sloop. And you do a random roll to see what your system players, pirates, get. In my case, actually, all of them this time happen to get a sloop. So that is slightly faster with a slightly lower combat. Their combat rating is at 5. Other things on this card. You have various cargo holds. Again, despite all these boxes here, it's curious to me that the sloop has 2 cargo holds, yet there's really no indication here of how to measure this, because there's various boats and they all seem to have 4. I don't know, I found that confusing, so I pull out one of the counters to indicate the 2 cargo holds here. And let's take a closer look at what your pirates offer you. Part of what makes this game, I think, a little bit confusing as to the genre that you would place it in, is that it has these sort of RPG elements to it, and the pirate card is a good example of this. You really are playing characters. Now, in the non-solitaire game, there, as the player, you have more interaction with different pirates, because you will be retiring pirates to convert their booty into net worth. But in the solitaire version, you stick with Blackbeard, but he is, you know, relatively a full-fledged character. So we're going to take a look here at what he has, or what all the pirates have, really. Taking it from the upper left, this initiative, this really refers to how active the pirate is. And when you pull an event card, such as the one here, and you see in this area the diamond, what it means is that you then can use the number of actions on a turn that are equal to your initiative. So obviously the higher initiative you have, the higher number of actions you have. Now in this case, Blackbeard's initiative is 3. There are some cards you pull that will give you the ability to use 3 actions, but there are also cards with the number in a circle that may be 1 or 2, so lower than your initiative. So that's what the initiative rating is. Your ability here, this is a dice roll modifier that will affect your naval and your combat skills, so obviously the higher the better on this. And ditto for leadership. Leadership refers to the pirate's ability to control the crew. There was something on the player mat that I didn't mention, this crew loyalty stat that can go up or down during the course of the game depending on what actions happen. It's sort of a clever little mechanic, I think, that adds a lot based on the theme. So for example, if you as a pirate come across a merchant ship, which remember are placed upside down on the board until you get there. So you sail all the way over to a merchant ship, and when it is revealed, well, this one, of course, happens to be a big one with a 3 cargo hold, but if you come to a merchant ship with small cargo holds, and when you roll on the table, you actually have not much in the ship, your crew is going to be upset with you, and your crew loyalty will go down. So the leadership modifies all of that on the tables to maintain crew loyalty. Moving down, we've got our cruelty rating. Of course, you're a pirate, so there are lots of things that you can do, including taking hostage, torturing hostages, killing them for information, and this higher the number on here, the more cruel you will be with the hostages that you take. The cunning number is used, you could think of this really as luck in a way. This is the rating that enables you to escape certain bad luck things, let's say, in the game that happen. And for the purposes of solitaire play, as I mentioned, there are no duels, so you would just ignore this duel rating. So these are some examples of the characteristics that your pirate will have and will come into play as basically DRMs as you play through the game, rolling on various tables to find the effects of various events. One of the nice things about this game is that for a solitaire game, you don't really feel as if you are locked into a step-by-step action in terms of what you can do on your turn. You have many actions that you can perform. Some of them are here, and there is a certain degree of freedom in looking at your situation on the map, deciding what you might do, and executing those actions. The downside, however, is the way the solitaire system works, and we're just going to take a look at this briefly here. If you have 3 actions to take, say, the solitaire rules state that after every single action you take, you must pull an event card, and depending on what the event card says, in this case, we're looking for one with an anti-pirate action here. If there is that anti-pirate action, this event must take place. So in effect, when you were playing this game, and we'll go back to remind you of the system player and its 3 pirates here, the game is set up to play as if it's a 4-player game. You are your 1 pirate, and you've got these other 4 pirates out there in the seas, potentially as the players would be in a multiplayer game, who have handful of cards that they can play, effectively playing cards against you. Because there are about 70% of these cards that have the anti-pirate action, about 70% of the time after you execute 1 action, if you pull a card, something else is going to occur. In my estimation, the overall effect of this can get relatively annoying as you play through, because you can't really get into a rhythm of planning out your actions, executing your actions, without having to stop, pull a card, and have the effect take place, which then, of course, you have to execute. So this is a bit awkward, I think, despite the fact that the system allows for some flexibility in terms of sailing around, deciding if you're going to sack a port, whether you're going to try to overtake a merchant ship. They are hostages sometimes that can be found and taken on ships, and then you have decisions to how you're going to treat the hostages. Are you going to try to torture them for information about ports and information that they give you? The port has a rating system here, and it will help you to, for a future port, attack that port, get more booty, ultimately get more victory points. So despite all of these things that are available to you, I find as the playthrough, having to, after every action, pull a card, execute the card, that is a little bit challenging. The next aspect of the solitaire play comes when you finish your turn. You then need to execute turns for every single one of the system player's pirates. So the way it works is you go, And for every action that you take, you potentially have an anti-pirate action card coming in. And then after all that, you need to play the cards for the system player's three pirates. Now, they don't have full hands of cards as you do. You have a hand of four cards yourself, but they do pull one card from each deck. So they pull a must play immediately card, and then they pull one of these maybe hold until played cards and execute those. So it gets to be, I feel, a lot of management of the system player's pirates to get back to your turn. And it does start to feel a little bit like you're just waiting to get back to your turn. So this is the flip side to the somewhat open nature of the game, where there are so many actions that can be taken. But in order to make all of that work as an entire system, with ships floating around and combat and ports being sacked and hostages being taken, you end up spending a lot of time managing the system player's turn. I was going to do a couple of examples of the gameplay, and when I started to film it, I just felt like, honestly, it would be too boring and really not illuminate anything that I haven't already said. So I'm skipping that to move on to talk about some thoughts about this game. But I did want to show you here some really cute things in the game. This is a hostage here, the governor's daughter, and the values on the hostage represent their worth and the information that they can give you, which will enable you to sack some ports with greater odds of success. Nice little touch here. There's some locals, officers. These can be found at various ports throughout the game. There's a captain, and they give you a nice little blank counter so you could make your own hostage. And here's an example of a warship. Oh, that would be a pretty good one there. So overall thoughts on this game as a solitaire game. The theme in this game really does come through well. You are, if you allow yourself to be, immersed in the life of a pirate, or at least the gamification of the life of a pirate. You're dealing with storms at sea, you're dealing with warship battles and possible mutinies on your own ship. You can have your crew undergo debauchery and revelry, and you can torture hostages and kill hostages and all sorts of things like that. Really, the mechanics of the solitaire play enable you to do everything in this game that you would be able to do with the multiplayer game, which is a benefit, with the exception of having the duels. They, as I mentioned, they don't have the duels in here. You can travel around to all the various ports that are in various nationalities, the English, Dutch, French, etc. And in a lot of ways, it's a really involving experience. And I think that the cards offer a nice way of getting in effects without you having to think about them so much. Quite clearly here, if this card is pulled by the system player, you're going to be placing a warship and following those rules. And then you'll have a warship out on the seas that you have to deal with. So all of that is really a positive. Of course, Richard Berg is a very, very well-known and prolific wargame designer, and I know that the origins of this game were somewhat different. The original 1989 version played very differently than this one and was more of a simulation. I think that really overall what this game, the challenge of playing this game, is that it is not exactly, well, it certainly isn't a wargame. It really is not exactly a simulation. It is not really a typical board game, because what you need to do to get up and running with this game, dealing with all of these counters that we have here, you know, punching them out, sorting through them, dealing with these player mats that even get much more detailed as you play the game. I haven't shown you this, but as you attack ports, you place the attack history here to indicate that this is no longer a friendly port for you. If you bribe some governors, you indicate that. So it gets filled with these small counters. All of these kind of machinations are really not something I think that a traditional person who plays traditional Euro games, even certainly traditional board games, would be used to or really wanting in their game. There's a bit of setup time, and there's just some fiddly nature with all of these different counters. So it's just a bit betwixt and between, I think, is the bottom line. Generally speaking, for solitaire play, to rank high in the solitaire standing, at least as far as I'm concerned, the solitaire rules really need to work as written. And here, I don't think they do. As I indicated earlier, it becomes 75% of management of the system player and what's going on and the anti-pirate actions against you, and really just like 25% you're playing your turn. Now, typically when I play a solitaire game, I look for games with solitaire built in because I don't like to be, in effect, playing two sides. I find that very difficult to do and not terribly enjoyable. Here, however, I did find that I created sort of my own hybrid variant where I actually played, it was a combination of the regular rules. So I played two pirates initially, and I had the system player playing their two pirates. I kept this division of the card deck, because I think this actually works fairly well to bring in random events and not have to think about it too much. But instead of playing my turn and then three, sort of waiting through three turns of the system player, I played my turn, I had the system player play theirs, I played my second pirate, and like this. That created, at least for me as a player, a more interest, more involvement, and less the feeling of waiting around. So in that regard, I think it's doable to do it that way, but it is not exactly as the rules are written. One of the things I think this game could be very effective in doing is in bringing people who are not familiar with the type of war game counters and setup a little experience of gameplay utilizing these types of components. And I think while I would not necessarily in any regard call this a gateway game to wargaming, I do think that if you have an interest in war games for any particular reason, but really aren't interested in traditional combat simulations, this is a nice hybrid type of game to possibly consider. You get the experience of punching out the counters and using counters, which some people may find interesting. And the counters here are quite nicely done, as I said at the beginning. They're colorful, they are sturdy, they really do fit with the theme. And you know, you get a little bit of the RPG feel too, as I said earlier as well. Back to looking at the Blackbeard pirate card, you're getting a sort of 360-degree view of a pirate, and gameplay when you get to retire your pirates and sort of put away their net worth to contribute to your victory points, you get a new pirate. There's a variability there that's quite nice. Getting back to the box here again, I already discussed the playing time. I do think that's fairly accurate once you know the rules. Again, we're looking at the solitaire play. I think it probably does play best, as the rule book actually says, with 2 to 3 rather than solitaire. So complexity, again, medium. It is very relatively smooth. I don't think the rules are really too difficult. They're lengthy if you're not used to this type of rule book, but they're relatively well organized. There's a lot of cross-referencing, but once you get it down, it's fairly intuitive. So, you know, when you discover a merchant ship, then you need to decide if you're going to loot it. And when you loot it, you need to figure out what the cargo is. And when you figure out the cargo, you need to determine if there are hostages, etc. All that is relatively straightforward once you get into the game and actually think, well, what would happen next? And it's pretty easy to look that up. Again, down to the final thought here on the solitaire suitability. Certainly, if you have any interest in the pirate theme, there are probably few and far games that do this. I think it executes that very well. It is fun, it is light. You can certainly get into the idea of, oh no, there's a warship on the horizon and there are some stormy seas a coming. You know, it does execute the theme very well. It is highly suitable for solitaire play because there are actually solitaire rules written in that work. My difficulty with it, and this is just a personal preference, was that I felt I needed to spend too much time getting that solitaire player in the game and, you know, essentially executing the AI to against how much time I was executing my own plans and ideas. Now, of course, this is not a game where you can have a strategic plan and execute it because there's just far too much randomness within it. But even so, just thinking about your own actions and what you might want to do, there's not a lot of time to do that because you really have to, every action you take, you need to pull a card and then execute whether or not there is that anti-pirate action. And I think I've sort of said that enough so you know that on my end, I found that to be a difficult way to play the game. So, in the end, what I say about Blackbeard is it's a fascinating and unique theme that really isn't treated in board games very much, and certainly not treated with the degree of detail that this one is. This is not a kid's game, and you know, again, that, and by that I mean it's not a game for young children. It is a game certainly for kids who are interested in gaming, but there is a fair degree of complexity. And while we didn't really look at the tables too much, there's a, you know, there's probably five or six tables that you need to use with the die as well. So finally, thoughts, if you're interested in pirates, if you're interested in a kind of unique solitaire game, and if you don't mind the fact that you will be spending more time on the AI execution than on your own plan, I say definitely run and pick this up. You can probably get it at a pretty good price. If you are somebody that does not like to spend a lot of time executing the AI, you might want to consider this one not to be in your play deck because it doesn't really play that smoothly in that regard. So there you have it. It's Richard Byrd's Blackbeard, The Golden Age of Piracy.